Good evening and welcome to News Tonight on Rajya Sabha TV. I'm Tina Jha. Let's begin with the day's top stories. India successfully hit satellite in low Earth orbit with a missile. Joined select club of US, China and Russia to have tested anti-satellite weapons. Prime Minister Modi announces news to the nation. Joins President, Vice President and others in congratulating DRDO scientists. India's anti-satellite test not directed against any country. Space capabilities do not threaten anyone. Ministry of External Affairs asserts government committed to ensuring country's national security interest. Election activity gathers pace across the country. Trinamool Congress releases election manifesto in West Bengal. BJP names three Lok Sabha candidates for Gujarat. Priyanka Gandhi Wadra meets Congress workers in Amethi. Debts Recovery Tribunal nets 1,000 crore rupees from sale of Vijay Mallya's UBHL shares. Enforcement agencies had seized fugitive businessmen's shares in connection with probe into money laundering charges. And in Sultan Azlan Shah hockey tournament, India notches third victory in four matches. Manpreet Singh scores hat-trick to help India beat Canada 7-3. Prime Minister Narendra Modi on Wednesday announced that India had demonstrated anti-satellite missile capability by shooting down a live satellite. In a special address to the nation, the Prime Minister announced the success of space operation Mission Shakti, describing it as a rare achievement that puts India in an exclusive club of space superpowers. Mission Shakti, led by the Defence Research and Development Organisation, is aimed at strengthening India's overall security and technological advancement. The ASAT missile shot down a predetermined target, orbiting at an altitude of 300 kilometres within 3 minutes of launch with remarkable precision and technical capability. Prime Minister Modi asserted that India's action was not directed against any country and that it was a test of the country's capability. India has now become only the fourth country in the world to test an anti-satellite weapon after the United States of America, Russia and China.
कुछ ही समय पूर्व हमारे वैज्ञानिकों ने अंतरिक्ष में स्पेस में 300 किलोमीटर दूर LEO लो अर्थ ऑर्बिट में एक लाइव सैटेलाइट को मार गिराया है. LEO लो ऑर्बिट में यह लाइव सैटेलाइट जो कि एक पूर्व निर्धारित लक्ष्य था उसे एंटी सैटेलाइट ASAT मिसाइल द्वारा मार गिराया गया है. सिर्फ 3 मिनट में सफलतापूर्वक यह ऑपरेशन पूरा किया गया है. मिशन शक्ति यह अत्यंत कठिन ऑपरेशन था. भारत हमेशा से ही अंतरिक्ष में हथियारों की होड़ के विरुद्ध रहा है और इससे इस नीति में कोई बदलाव नहीं आया है. आज का यह परीक्षण किसी भी तरह के अंतर्राष्ट्रीय कानून अथवा संधि समझौतों का उल्लंघन नहीं करता है. हम आधुनिक तकनीक का उपयोग देश के 130 करोड़ नागरिकों की सुरक्षा एवं उनके कल्याण के लिए ही करना चाहते हैं. भारत ने आज अपना नाम अंतरिक्ष महाशक्ति स्पेस पावर के रूप में दर्ज करा दिया है। अब तक दुनिया के तीन देश अमेरिका, रूस और चीन को यह उपलब्धि हासिल थी। अब भारत चौथा देश है जिसने आज यह सिद्धि प्राप्त की है। हर हिंदुस्तानी के लिए इससे बड़े गर्व का पल नहीं हो सकता है।
Reacting to the successful anti-satellite missile test, President Ramnath Kovind called it a watershed moment for India. He said the anti-satellite missile test demonstrates India's scientific prowess and commitment to harnessing space technology for the security and empowerment of our people. Vice President M. Venkaiah Naidu also congratulated the scientists on the successful test and said that the nation was proud of them. Several political leaders also reacted to the launch. In a series of tweets, Union Minister Harshvardhan congratulated the scientists of ISRO and DRDO on the success of the mission. He said, India is now capable of defending itself on land, air, water and space. Home Minister Rajnath Singh called the achievement glorious and said the successful mission will strengthen India's defense capabilities.
इसका पूरा प्रक्रिया 2014 के बाद जब प्रधानमंत्री जी ने अनुमति दी और हमारे वैज्ञानिकों ने इस शोध का कार्य किया है, जो पुराने युद्ध होते थे और जो अगले युग के युद्ध होंगे वो अलग अलग होंगे। इस विश्व की उस जियोपॉलिटिकल सिचुएशन में हैं जिसमें हमारी तैयारी ही हमारा सबसे बड़ा डेटरेंट है। भारत की केवल शक्ति ही नहीं बढ़ेगी, हमारी क्षमता की इस क्षेत्र के अंदर हम शांति कायम रखें।
बीजेपी प्रेसिडेंट अमित शाह आल्सो हेल्ड द अचीवमेंट ऑफ द साइंटिस्ट। एट द सेम टाइम ही हिट बैक एट द ऑपोजिशन आफ्टर सेवरल पार्टी लीडर्स अक्यूज द प्राइम मिनिस्टर ऑफ प्लेइंग पॉलिटिक्स ओवर द अचीवमेंट्स ऑफ द साइंटिस्ट। In a tweet, Amit Shah alleged that the UPA lacked courage to support institutions and people. Union Minister Arun Jaitley also accused the previous government at the center of lacking capability and clarity.
मुझे लगता है कि बालाकोट और पुलवामा में एक ऐतिहासिक भूल करने के बाद इतिहास ने हिंदुस्तान के विपक्ष को एक और अवसर दिया उस गलती को सुधारने का, कि जब हमारे वैज्ञानिकों ने अब देश की ताकत बढ़ाई है, कम से कम उस देश के विश्वास के साथ, देश के कॉन्फिडेंस के साथ, उन वैज्ञानिकों के साथ तो खड़े होकर अपना दायित्व निभाइए।
द मिनिस्ट्री ऑफ एक्सटर्नल अफेयर्स सेड इन अ स्टेटमेंट दैट इंडिया हैज नो इंटेंशन ऑफ एंटरिंग इनटू एन आर्म्स रेस इन आउटर स्पेस। इन अ 10-point डिटेल एक्सप्लेनेशन द मिनिस्ट्री ऑफ एक्सटर्नल अफेयर्स सेड The test was carried out to verify India's capability to safeguard space assets and that it was not directed against any country. The MEA also said the test was done in the lower atmosphere to ensure there is no space debris. The reaction from the MEA came after Pakistan, in a written statement, said that it was against the militarization of outer space. China also reacted in a guarded manner to India's test and expressed hope that all countries will uphold peace and tranquility in the outer space. And time now for all the election-related news. The Election Commission has set up a panel of officers to examine Prime Minister Narendra Modi's address to the nation on Wednesday to examine whether it violated the Model Code of Conduct. The decision was taken after the Commission held an internal consultation on Prime Minister's address, successfully testing an anti-satellite missile on Wednesday morning. According to senior officials, the panel will seek a transcript of the Prime Minister's speech from the government immediately and look into the urgency of the address to the nation. TMC chief and West Bengal chief minister Mamata Banerjee on Wednesday released her party's manifesto. She said the manifesto focuses on issues of national importance for the upcoming Lok Sabha elections. The manifesto promises a revival of the planning commission and 200 days work with double pay for MGNREGA workers. Mamata Banerjee said that her party will review the GST and will simplify it if voted to power. She also said that her party will discuss these issues with other political parties as well before finalizing on a common minimum program. Elections for the 42 Lok Sabha seats in West Bengal will be held in 7 phases. Meanwhile, Congress General Secretary Priyanka Gandhi Vadra campaigned in Amethi, the constituency of her brother and Congress President Rahul Gandhi. Interacting with the booth workers in Amethi, Priyanka said, "Amethi is like family and home to the Gandhi family." She told the party workers to reach out to the villages. She also said the Congress party fulfills its promises, pointing out that farm loans were waived soon after the Rajasthan government was formed. The Congress leader also said her party had promised to give 72,000 rupees yearly to poor families and will fulfill the promise if voted to power. Actor Urmila Matondkar on Wednesday joined the Congress party after meeting party president Rahul Gandhi at his residence. She joined the party in the presence of Maharashtra Congress chief Milind Devora and Sanjay Nirupam. Addressing a press conference after joining the party, Urmila said she believes in the ideology of the grand old party.
आज के दौर में जबकि केंद्र में ये पार्टी सत्ता में ना होने के बावजूद मैं पूरे जद्दोजहद से मैं पूरे अपने थिंकिंग मेरे पूरे जो आचार विचार सबके साथ अगर इस कांग्रेस पार्टी से जुड़ना चाहती हूँ. मैंने मेरी ज़िंदगी में कोई चीज़ हाफ हार्टेडली नहीं की है, ना मैं ये करना चाहूँगी, क्योंकि जब आप लोगों के बीच उनकी सेवा करने का अंदेशा लेके जाते हो तो ये बहुत बड़ी रिस्पॉन्सिबिलिटी होती है. तो मैं कहीं जाने वाली हूँ नहीं, मैं यहीं हूँ और बहुत बहुत शुक्रिया.
And Bhojpuri singer and actor Dinesh Lal Yadav Nirahua joined the Bhartiya Janata Party on Wednesday. He joined the party in Lucknow in the presence of Uttar Pradesh Chief Minister Yogi Adityanath. The actor said he will fight the elections if the party decides to field him.
हम जो है वो भारतीय जनता पार्टी के साथ हैं. हम भी चाहते हैं कि देश में जो है फिर से नरेंद्र मोदी जी प्रधानमंत्री बने और इसलिए हम जुड़ रहे हैं और आगे जो भी आदेश होगा.
बीजेपी एमपी अंशुल वर्मा जॉइन द समाजवादी पार्टी ऑन वेंसडे. दिस आफ्टर ही वाज डिनाइड टिकट बाय द पार्टी फॉर द अपकमिंग लोकसभा इलेक्शंस. ही जॉइन द समाजवादी पार्टी इन द प्रेजेंस ऑफ अखिलेश यादव. Tumkur, a semi-urban constituency barely 62 kilometers from Bengaluru, is shaping into a tough battle for the Congress-JDS alliance. It has also armed the BJP with ammunition to question the JDS that it is not being able to look beyond its first family. Here's a report from our correspondent Rajat K.
An intense battle is on the cards for the Tumkur Lok Sabha seat. JDS patriarch H.D. Devgowda is in the fray as the joint candidate of the Congress-JDS alliance. But all is not rosy for Gowda. The Congress had won the seat in 2014 and the party is not happy for giving the seat to the JDS.
Today, the Tumkur voters are supporting Mr. Devgowda and basically it is a JDS constituency. In last assembly segment election also, we have taken upper hand. 3 MLAs are belongs to the JDS, 1 MLA belongs to the Congress party, and the total vote sharing, around 7 lakh votes polled in favor of JDS and Congress, around 4 lakh votes polled in favor of BJP. So the ground reality is very good. That is why we have decided to field Mr. Devgowda as a candidate.
The main rival, the BJP, is questioning the JDS on playing dynastic politics. Not only Devgowda, even two grandsons, Nikhil Gowda from Mandya and Prajwal Revanna from Hassan, are contesting the elections, which means the first family of the JDS is contesting 3 of the 7 seats it has been given.
Also, you said they're contesting 7 seats, but they had to give up on one seat, which is Bangalore North, because they could not find another candidate from within their family to contest the seat. So this only shows that there is lack of leadership in the party, and it is clearly very feudalistic in nature, equivalent to that of the Congress, where you cannot go beyond the Gandhi family when it comes to leadership. And the same can be seen in the case of JDS as well.
The battle in Tumkur is not just a straight contest between the Congress-JDS alliance and the BJP. The entry of Mudda Hanumegowda, who is a sitting MP and now a Congress rebel, contesting as an independent, has opened up calculations. The Congress party is, however, sure that they'll convince the rebel to back the official candidate and also to take back his nomination.
Complicating the Tumkur battle is the entry of sitting MP and now Congress rebel Mudda Hanumegowda. The Congress says it's confident of convincing him to step down in favor of the coalition candidate. The party is well aware that it needs to keep its house in order to pose any challenge to the BJP candidate, former MP G.S. Basava Raju.
Then again, 29th is the withdrawal date. So I am confident that I will persuade him to withdraw. And I will also persuade Mr. Rajanna, who is also applied it from our own party. If these two withdraw on 29th, I think we will have absolutely no problem. But in case, if both of them contest, then we will have a different political strategy. In spite of that, we will definitely win this seat.
For the JDS, winning the seat has become not only a matter of preserving cohesion with its coalition partner, but also ensuring the future of the next generation of the Gowda family. Rajat Kent's report for Rajya Sabha TV.
And time now for a short break, but news and updates will continue on the other side. Do stay with us. Welcome back. You're watching News Tonight. Vice President M. Venkaiah Naidu has asked journalists to serve as a mirror to the society and be the voice of the voiceless people, asserting that an efficient and fearless media was necessary for a democratic country like India. The Vice President asked media to portray the reality as it is, without magnifying or diminishing or distorting the facts. He also said media is expected to not just report accurately, but also to highlight social and economic injustices. The Vice President asked media to play a vital role in creating awareness and empowering citizens by making them aware of their inalienable rights. He also pointed out that the media has a crucial role to play, especially during elections.
With advances in information and communication technologies, the reach of media has increased manifold. There is therefore a need for the media to handle its influencing capacity with a deeper sense of responsibility to the nation. It is often said that pen is mightier than the sword. Media should wield the immense power at its disposal with great discretion and self-restraint. It should be the democracy's most potent weapon in fighting social prejudices, fundamentalism, dogmatism, and social evils.
The Vice President has also called upon all educational institutions to become centers of excellence, providing quality, affordable, meaningful education to students. Presenting the Ranking of Engineering and Management Educational Institutes in India Awards, the Vice President asked educational institutions to interact and work with industry so as to train students to compete in the global job market. He also stressed on the need to attach more importance to knowledge and skill while designing the curriculum. Talking about India's growth story and its prospects, the Vice President said the youth participation was an essential component in taking new strides. He also said there is a need for special focus on rural India by making agriculture more viable and profitable.
The future of the country and our society is taking shape in their dreams of these youngsters. As a society, we need to respect aspirations, attitude and capabilities of our youth. We are fortunate that we have 65% of our population which is below 35 years of age. We need to realize this demographic dividend. If we can sustain our high growth rate, we need to train our youth and impart higher order of skills.
On the third day of his visit to Croatia, President Ramnath Kovind addressed the Croatian-Indian Economic Forum in capital Zagreb on Wednesday. He urged the Indian and Croatian businesses to partner for trade, technology and investment collaboration. He said India can be a partner in Croatia's development by providing skilled manpower in information technology, construction, hospitality and health sectors, as well as enhanced cooperation in the services sector. Later, he also addressed students at the University of Zagreb.
I invite Indian and Croatian businesses to partner with each other for trade, technology and investment collaboration. In today's globalized world, we cannot think only in terms of export and import. We must also look at integrating our value and supply chains to derive maximum benefit. I am happy that India-Croatia Business Council has been set in place. We need to energize it and seek its assistance in identifying new areas of cooperation.
Economic fugitive Vijay Mallya's 74 lakh UBHL shares have been sold for 1,008 crore rupees. The Enforcement Directorate has informed that these shares were attached as part of its money laundering probe against Mallya. The Karnataka High Court had recently ordered Yes Bank to hand over these shares in favour of the Debt Recovery Tribunal located in Bengaluru. The ED and the CBI are probing parallel criminal cases against Vijay Mallya for an alleged bank loan default of 9,000 crore rupees. And news now from the Sultan Azlan Shah Hockey Tournament, where India booked a place in the final of the Sultan Azlan Shah Cup with a 7-3 win over Canada in a goal-laden league match on Wednesday in Malaysia. Striker Mandeep Singh scored a brilliant hat-trick as India outplayed Canada to book a summit clash berth against Korea. India's place in the final was confirmed after Korea defeated host Malaysia 2-1 in the final match of the day. India and Korea are the two undefeated teams in the tournament with 10 points each and will face off in the finals on Saturday. And that's it from us in this bulletin. Thank you very much for your time.